Alright, let's start off another one. I've already started fiddling around the Norton. Actually, the last 4 days I've been out in the yard humping soil around for the wife and that. And anyway, I know she appreciates me doing that heavy work for her because she's the gardener around here, not me. But anyway, I also found a little bit of time to tinker with this a bit. I did remove the crash bars and the old the rack and the pannier racks from the back there. I really don't know. I'm getting ahead of myself, I know, with this whole thinking about things in the future. I don't know what I'm going to do about that exhaust system. In a way, I kind of like it because it's pretty damn unusual. Now, like I said before, I know those mufflers, at least I don't think those mufflers are correct for this bike, and it's got like a lot of mileage on it. What's it say there? Almost 58,000. So I'm quite sure that those mufflers have been replaced. I suspect it probably came with the old cigar type mufflers, and maybe that's what I'll try to put on it, or maybe I'll come up with something else, like the ones I have over here on this bike. They're not an expensive muffler. MGO makes them. Yes, MGO. But they are very, very, very similar to the old the Dunstall Megaton mufflers that they had. So they'd be period correct on that bike, because they're what I put on the old Atlas when I had that. And they looked really good on them. Like I say, they muffle really well. And that bike just sounds incredible when it's running. So I may try to figure out a way to use those on here. But anyway, I don't know. This morning I pulled the plugs out because a good friend of mine, Adam Burton, he's got his own channel there, ECRN Garage. If you want to see some pretty neat stuff going on, you can watch his videos. Anyway, he suggested that I do a compression check on the engine, and I said, well, you know, I'm going to tear it down anyway, but curiosity wins, so I am going to do a compression test on it here just to see what it's got, but I know it doesn't have much compression because it does roll over awful easy. Anyways, it's been sitting there dry for years. And I've had a heck of a job getting that left spark plug out of there. Like, I was actually afraid that I was going to strip the threads in the head, but luckily it didn't hurt the threads at all. It was just a dry and tight fit. So anyway, I've oiled those cylinders up, and I'm going to stick a compression tester in it and see what we've got. All right, I just finished doing a compression test on the bike. I guess I could have videotaped myself jumping up and down on the darn thing, but what's the point of that? Anyway, the great thing about doing a compression test on a bike with no carburetors is you don't have to hold the friggin' throttle open. Anyway, the left and the right cylinders both showed 60 PSI, which is only about 100 PSI less than it should be. So anyway, it definitely needs some work going on in there. And well, with that kind of mileage on this engine, it's probably been rebuilt at least once, but I'll find out when I get in there, because I want to know what's down in the bottom end for main bearings and that. I mean, did they leave the old ball and roller bearings in, or did they replace them with super blends? I don't know, but I'll find out. What else? Gas tank. When I took that off, I had a look inside it. I'm not going to try to get in there with a flashlight because I don't think the camera will pick it up. You can see a little bit around here. That red stuff you see is actually the candy coat from the old paint job. So she was a real pretty red with metal flake in it. I can say I'm not even going to try to put a light in there because it'd be so bright the camera wouldn't pick it up anyway. Anyhow, the inside of that tank, besides smelling like rotten gas, it's been repaired, and I don't know what they put in it. It looks like it might have been fiberglass resin or something. So at one point, the darn thing was probably leaking, and so They tried to repair it. So I'm not frigging around with that tank. I haven't got the time or the patience to try to fix something like that. I will simply buy a new tank. But that's something for down the road, after the engine's completed and I'm putting the bike back together. Because I tell you, there's nothing more sickening than thinking that you've repaired an old fiberglass tank and getting a lovely paint job done on it, and then 2 weeks later finding out your paint job's been ruined because your tank's leaking. So, like I say, I'm just going to get a new tank for it. It might be a little bit expensive, but it's worth it in the long run. And I'll keep this one just because it's original to the bike. So that's all I've got for now. I guess the next thing to do is get her up on the lift and start taking her apart. Okay, that exhaust system came off pretty darn easy. All I had to do was give those exhaust collars, well, I did put a little bit of penetrating oil on them a couple of days ago, but anyway, I just gave them about six sharp cracks with a 1 pound ball peen hammer, and I put the hook spanner on them, and they screwed right off. The last time I did this, that was on that Atlas I'm always talking about, I had to beat them out. It took probably all morning to get those exhaust collars out of that bike, but this one here, they just screwed right out, no problem at all. The threads appear to be in really nice shape in there too, which is a bit of a blessing because sometimes the threads get worried right out of these things, and then you have to come up with other ways of putting your head pipes on, like this one here. That actually works really well, those two clamping bolts in there. I weld in between the fins and then tap them out, put studs in. And anyway, I've done that repair for a few different fellas besides myself. But anyway, it works. And anyway, the bike is starting to look a little more naked now. I guess the next thing to do would be start removing some of the other things that hold on to the engine, like that top engine mount. Hey, that's loose already. He must have been planning on taking this all apart at one point, because he took the foot peg off the other side. So the only reason you'd be doing that was would have been to get at the primary. And anyway, I'll get the coils out of the way too. And by the time I get that stuff off of there, I'll just cut off the old oil lines. I'm not even going to try to save them, because they're like 54 or 55 years old, something like that right now. So I'll just replace them with new ones when I put the engine back together. And this steel oil feed line going up to the top end, it looks in good shape, but frankly I don't trust them, because I've had bikes come here before with those oil feed lines where the soldering had come undone in them, and that, holy crap, bike just covered in oil, because they take full oil pump pressure up to the heads on these. So I will probably put a set of those nice stainless steel braided hoses up there, because you never have to worry about those breaking. Anyway, I'll get on with the job and post a little more later. Okay, we got Elton John in the background playing Crocodile Rock. Anyways, I've got all the interference gear that was in here out of the way. And what I decided to do was partially dismantle the engine before I take it out of the frame. There's two reasons for that. Number one is I'm curious to see what's under there. Number two was to make the engine lighter when I go to lift it out. So anyways, I did have one little spot of difficulty with the cylinder head, and there's one little friggin' nut that lives down here in that slotted area. I don't know if you can see it or not, but that slotted area in the back of the cylinder, there's a nut that goes onto a stud from underneath. Now, usually it's not a problem unless you forget that it's there, but this one here, it had the, let me see if I can find it. Here it is, yes. It had the corners rounded off
So when I went to take it off, the wrench just kind of spun around on it, and I thought, crap, what am I going to do with that? So anyway, it held me up for about a half an hour, but I managed to make up a, what was it be, I guess, a 9-point box end wrench. I filed three of the flats big enough to for that nut to go inside of that wrench, and anyway, it worked perfectly, so I have another special tool in my collection that I will put in the drawer with the other special tools, but I'm going to have to do something with that nut, maybe replace it all together, or anyway, I'm not going to put that back together with that on it, because I don't want anybody else to be faced with that sort of a problem. But anyway, all the cylinder head bolts are out. I'm curious to see what I find in there. I don't think it's going to be anything too special. Probably just a couple of oily black pistons and a greasy old cylinder head. But I'm going to set this down here. And hopefully, you'll be able to see what I'm doing. The great thing about this is the valve springs, when you loosen up all these nuts and stuff, the valve springs just push the head off. So you don't need to worry about it being stuck to the gasket. So, here we go. Let's hold her up there. The head gasket is stuck on. Those rods will probably give me a little bit of trouble. Filming my foolhardiness, so I'm gonna shut this off for a second and get that off of there. Okay, I got it. I forgot that there's a certain way you have to tilt those heads. You need to tilt the head forward after you hold all four of those push rods up inside the head. Then you can get the head off inside the frame like that. So anyway, there's nothing in here that's really a big surprise. Just like I said, greasy, dirty old oily cylinder head. I'm gonna scrape the muck off of those pistons and see if I can find out if I have standard jugs or oversized. I'm quite sure they're probably oversized, but anyways, I'm going to find out. There, they're all cleaned up. Let's see if I can pick that up with the camera. There, right there. 40 thou. She's currently on a 40 thou overbore. Hopefully I won't have to get a rebore done, but time will tell. Anyways, I'll have to get the jugs off next, and then I can measure them. And again, taking those heavy cylinders off will make it a whole lot easier to get the crankcase over the cranks. So anyway, for now, I'll just shut this off and I'll get the jugs up. Okay. I had a little bit of trouble when I tried to videotape the head off, so let's see if the cylinders give me the same problem. Should not do. Anyway, I'm just going to grab a hold of them, and it should pull right off there. There we go. I've got to tell you, at first glance, those bores look really good. Set this over here on the bench. Grab the camera here. Those bores, like I say, at first glance, they look pretty smooth. Doesn't seem to be a ridge at the top, just a bit of dirt. But geez, if I'm lucky, I may not have to have those cylinder bored. But, anyway, what do we got for pistons here? Okay. These are the famous pop-top pistons. There's a slot, can't see it right now because the rings are there, but there's a slot that goes in behind the oil ring right around here. And of course that's to let the oil drain off. But the problem with it is, the whole top part, whoops, I'll get the camera in the right place here. The whole top part of that piston, it's only held on to the piston skirt by this little section right here And sometimes when things get overheated and you're playing with the bike a little too hard, the top of those pistons can come right off. And anyway, it wreaks havoc on the engine itself. So anyway, that's as far as I'm going as far as tearing this down goes at the moment. I may just take those pistons off for fun, but the next thing to do to get the engine out, of course, will be to open up that primary drive, remove the clutch and the triplex chain and all that. Then we'll get that front engine mount off of there and see about getting that engine out. Anyway, that's enough for now. I think I'll go in and have a cup of tea. Thanks for watching. One more thing here with this video before I call it done for now. The rod tip on the crankshaft, very little rod tip, so that tells me that those crankshaft bearings are in very good condition. I don't know what regrind they're at, but I'll find out. Anyway, the camshafts look like they're, well, cam lobes, I should say, look like they're just brand new in there. And anyway, that's it for now. I'll keep you posted. Thanks for watching.